So in the last lecture, we were looking at direct methods for solving sparse linear systems. Sparse linear systems are ones in which the matrix is filled with lot of zeros, very few non-zero elements. And towards the end of the lecture, we looked at the Thomas algorithm. The Thomas algorithm is for tri-diagonal systems. Before that, we also looked at block diagonal systems. Block diagonal systems, you can exploit the structure to come up with a computation method which is significantly, you know, computationally efficient as compared to the conventional Gaussian elimination. So now to continue with this, we looked at Thomas algorithm yesterday, and I said that the number of multiplications and divisions is linearly proportional to n, which is significant reduction from n cubed by 3, particularly for large dimensional matrices. If you have n to be 1000, n cubed by 3 would be a very large number as compared to 5n minus 8. Just compare the number of multiplications and divisions that you have to do for a modest n of 1000. Okay, so just continuing on this, I'm going to talk today about Thomas algorithm for block triangular matrices or block tridiagonal matrices. So for sparse systems, we looked at tridiagonal systems, and now we'll look at this special class, which is so this is a block this is a matrix so I am trying to solve an equation AX where A is given by this matrix. Okay, I'm going to split again X into sub vectors. So I have this vector x1 x2 up to xn. So this is a block tridiagonal system. Okay, earlier case we had scalars here. In earlier case, beta b1 b c1 a2 b2 c2, all these were scalars, and then what we had derived earlier was Thomas algorithm when the diagonal matrices are scalar. If you look carefully, this matrix which you get here is not really tridiagonal, because each one of them could be a dense matrix. Each one of them could be a dense matrix. So if each one of them is a dense matrix, the raw matrix is not blocked, is not tridiagonal. It may have multiple diagonals. Okay, but we are able to identify this B1, C1, A2, B2, C2 and so on, such that this is a block tridiagonal matrix. What I mean by block tridiagonal matrix? The so-called elements of this matrix are themselves matrices. B1 is a matrix, C1 is a matrix, A1 is a matrix, A2, B2 is a matrix, C2 is a matrix of appropriate dimension. Is everyone with me on this? Is this clear? See, these are sub matrices within this huge matrix. These are sub matrices. Okay, so this could be a 3x3, this could be a 3x3, this would be then Let's say this is 4 cross 4, then this will be 4 cross 3 and so on. Okay, we'll have to have appropriate dimensions here. They need not be all of the same dimension, they can be of different dimensions. Okay, so now I want to exploit the spatial structure this has, a lot of zeros or zero matrices, or these are zero matrices. Okay, that's why I'm writing them in square brackets. So this is a huge matrix whose elements are submatrices. Okay, these are subvectors. X superscript 1 and X superscript 2 are subvectors of appropriate dimension. Okay, if this is 3 cross 3, this X1 will be 3 cross 1 and so on. Okay, if this matrix is 4 cross 4, this X2 will be 4 cross 1 and so on. So this matrix has appropriate dimensions. So these are submatrices, which are and these are subvectors. The right hand side also has been divided into subvectors, and now I am just going to apply the Thomas algorithm that we came up with. The first step, the step one is step one is called block triangularization. What do you do in Gaussian elimination? What do we do in Gaussian elimination? In Gaussian elimination, we make the diagonal below the main diagonal 0. Okay. Here, we are not going to make the diagonal 0. We are going to make the block diagonal below main block diagonal 0. Okay, so we are going to retain matrices along the main diagonal. I am going to retain matrices along the main diagonal. I am going to make everything that is below that is 0. Okay. So this block triangularization would be, first matrix is gamma 1 is B1 inverse C1, and gamma k is, if you look at the Thomas algorithm which I developed for the scalar case, you would notice that what I am doing here, it just a matrix analog of what I have done for the scalar case. It's not different. Okay, so earlier I had written scalar gamma, I am writing here capital gamma. Okay, you have to be careful now because you have matrices. You have to talk about pre-multiplication, post-multiplication very, very carefully. Okay, you cannot interchange the order, and whatever was a division earlier would come out to be a matrix inverse here and so on. Then you have this beta 1 vector will be B1 inverse D1. So you have to worry about these elements when we do the transformation to block triangularization. And beta k will be bk. Yes, we'll say bk. So my first step is block triangularization. Okay, so in the block triangularization step, what I'm going to do is, if I go back here, I'm going to replace this by, I'm going to replace this by I 0 I. So all these will be replaced by identity matrices of appropriate dimension. Everything below the main diagonal will be null matrices, and these upper one will be replaced by gamma 1. gamma 1, this will be gamma 2, and this will be gamma n. These vectors will be replaced by beta 1, beta 2, beta n. Okay? So I have done block triangularization. Okay? This is block diagonal identity. This is gamma 1, gamma 2, which we are calculating here. Now notice one thing, even though you are doing matrix inversions here, these are small dimension matrices. Each one of them is 3 cross 3, 4 cross 4, whatever. Even if it is 10 cross 10, these are small dimension matrices as compared to the big matrix. So the individual inverses which are involved here are small dimension inverses. So these you could compute by some standard method, Gauss-Jordan method basically. So this you can do quick computations because the number of computations involved is relatively small as compared to the big matrix. Okay, if I were to apply Gaussian elimination to the big matrix, the computations will be much, much more than doing these small inverses. Okay, so that is why. The next step is, of course, backward sweep. So in backward sweep, we start from this end. Okay, look at this, I times xn is equal to beta n. So this is my first, so this itself is the solution for xn component. Okay, using xn component in the second equation, I can recover xn minus 1, xn minus 2, I go back and then I recover the entire state vector. So this algorithm, it exploits large number of zeros. So actually, if you go back and look at this matrix in its original form, right now I have written it in a block triangular or block tri-diagonal matrix form. In original form, this will be a banded matrix. Okay, so there are few diagonals which are non-zero. Okay, rest all above and below are zero. We are able to express those diagonals in terms of these matrices, sub-matrices. Okay, and that's why we are able to come up with a computationally efficient solution for solving this particular problem. Okay, there are many other such forms, and as I told you that if you go to MATLAB toolbox, you will find there's a MATLAB toolbox for sparse systems, and there are many more forms. Another simple form is to solve are triangular matrices. Triangular matrices are either lower triangular matrices or upper triangular matrices. Now, where do you get upper triangular, lower triangular matrices? In Gaussian elimination, you get lower triangular, upper triangular matrices, right? In Gaussian elimination, you will get an upper triangular matrix, and then you do backward sweep, right? Which is, so if you have a lower triangular matrix, you can do computations very fast. And then likewise, if you have a block lower triangular matrix, okay, you can come up with an algorithm which is, again, very fast and exploit the structure, not worry about the zeros which are there, and then try to come up with a solution. Just look at the notes. I'm not going to do it on the board. We have to move on to something else. There's one more concept I want to introduce here. Now, block triangular or lower triangular, upper triangular, these are special structures, and likewise you can go on exploiting these structures to come up with efficient Gaussian elimination algorithms or efficient modifications of Gaussian elimination algorithms which are suited for a specific structure, and you can do fast computations. That is the idea. So as I said, my motivation behind talking about sparse matrices was to sensitize you that there exists something called sparse matrix computations. Okay. Now, what is the origin of these problems? Is problem discretization, that is discretization of boundary value problems, discretization of partial differential equations, okay, on finite element or finite difference, all these methods, orthogonal collocations on finite elements, all these will give rise to certain nice structures which has lot of zeros, and then you can exploit that to come up with solutions which are efficient. This is particularly useful when you have iterative procedures. In iterative procedures, you may have to solve Ax equal to b kind of equations, Newton-Raphson. Okay, you are actually solving multiple times Ax equal to b. Okay, you never actually, when you actually do Newton-Raphson step, you never, in a large scale problem, you never do A inverse. It's fine to do it for a beginner, you know, a problem which has three variables or four variables. But when you have large number of equations, and when you are doing Newton-Raphson, you actually solve A delta x equal to minus f at xk, solve a linear problem, and then substitute delta x and get a new x. Okay, so you have to solve multiple times linear algebraic equations, and that's where exploiting the structure. Now, if your solution scheme gives rise to a specific structure to A matrix, that will happen in every iteration. It is not going to be different. Only the numbers will change iteration to iteration. The structure of the matrix will remain same. Okay, so if you are calling a specific subroutine, sparse subroutine, within your Newton-Raphson, that subroutine will remain same. It's not going to change. Okay, so if I am doing the problem, this TRAM problem. Okay, in TRAM problem, suppose I decide to do, say, orthogonal collocations on finite elements, so three finite elements. Every time I'll get a matrix in the iterations whose numbers might change, but the structure will be same. Okay, the wherever zeros appear, zeros will appear every time. That is because of your structure of discretization. Okay, or if you decide to do it using finite difference. Okay, within the iterations, that matrix is always going to be tridiagonal. It's not going to change. Okay, so those features will remain same. Those features are not going to change. Just remember that. So you can actually make use of those features and come up with. There's one more trick for reducing the computations. This is, if you have a large system. Now I'm not talking about, sparse matrices. The thing what I'm going to talk about need not be a sparse matrix, but it's a trick to make computations fast. So solving a matrix by matrix partitioning. Okay, I'm going to explain the basic concept. It can be extended to more complex partitioning. I want to solve Ax equal to b, of course, where A is a large matrix. I don't want to invert the large matrix, or I don't want to use Gaussian elimination on the entire big matrix. One possibility is that I transform this equation into two sub equations. Okay, so this A matrix is written as a partition A11, A12, A21, A22. So this big matrix A, I am going to partition into four sub matrices. Okay, well, if some of them, let's say this one is almost a null matrix, or this is a null matrix, great, you know, you have a simplified solution x1, x2, and b1, b2. So I'm going to partition this equation. Okay, how will I proceed now? The way I am going to proceed is, well, I will say that we have two equations, A11 x1 plus A12 x2 is equal to B1. Can you try and solve this? Can you make an attempt? How will I proceed now? Let us say A11 is invertible. Then can you eliminate and write? Can I eliminate x1 using the first equation? How do you solve? Suppose I decide to write x1 as A11 inverse B1 minus A12. X2. What next? How do I solve the next part? I just take the second equation. Okay. A21 x1 plus A22 x2 is equal to B2. Okay. And then I substitute this x1 here. Okay. So it is A21 A11 inverse B1 minus A12 x2 plus A22 x2 is equal to B2. And now I can rearrange. I can put all the terms of x together. Okay, I can put all the terms of x together. So I will get an equation which is A21 A11 inverse A12 minus plus A22 x2 is equal to B2 minus what is the advantage of doing this? See, n cube, you just remember that Gaussian elimination would require computations to the proportion of n cube by 3. Okay. Suppose this is 1000 cross 1000 matrix. I decide to divide it into 500 cross 500, 500 cross 500. Okay. So this will be the first problem. First problem, I have to do a Gauss-Jordan for a 500 cross 500 matrix. Okay, and next time, so I'll get an A inverse A11 inverse once. I'll store it. I'll use it in the next step. Again, I have to do a Gaussian elimination of 500 cross 500. Two Gaussian eliminations of 500 cross 500 requires less computations than 1000 cross 1000. Okay, 2500 cross 500 is less than 1000 cross 1000. So likewise, I have just done a simple partitioning here. I could think of A11, A12, A13, A21, A22, A23. I can make multiple partitions. Actually, matrix theory is very, very interesting, and it has history of almost more than 100 years, 100, 150 years. Kelly was one of the founders of matrix theory. You probably know Kelly-Hamilton theorem. Kelly and who was the second mathematician? I forget his name. I'll try to remember and tell you. They were friends, and incidentally, Kelly's friend. So he didn't get, though he was a mathematician, that time in England, if you have to be graduate, you had to take an oath to be a devout Christian. and he was a Jew and he refused to take that oath. So he was not given a degree in mathematics. So he took to law. Okay. And during the recess, during the, you know, cold recess between two sessions, these two guys used to work on matrix theory. That's what troubles us now. But they came up with voluminous matrix theory, which is now, they are known as twins of, I'll tell you the name tomorrow. So there's lot to matrix theory, and a lot of things have been developed. The Bible of matrix theory would be, there's a book called Gantmacher. Okay. This book was published in, I think, 1945. We have this book in the library. It's like, it's two times Perry's handbook. It's huge. And this is in 1945. So you can imagine what must be matrix theory by now. I don't think you can have it in this. So what actually we look at as a matrix theory is just tip of the iceberg. And linear equation solving is something that that's just bread and butter of numerical computing. So you need it everywhere. It's you cannot live without. Okay. So this is about sparse matrices or matrix partitioning, and you have all kinds of tricks to make your computations faster. Now I'm going to move from, but this method which I talked about, matrix partitioning, was still belonging to the direct methods. I have not gone to iterative methods yet. Now I'm going to move on to iterative methods. So iterative methods, the idea is that you start with a guess solution. Okay. So I want to solve again Ax equal to b, and then many times, well, it's difficult to come up with a general number of multiplications and divisions for iterative methods. But in general, the number of multiplications and divisions for iterative methods can be much smaller than the Gaussian elimination based methods. So iterative schemes. And next few lectures, I'm just going to spend on how to solve this problem iteratively. So what is iterative schemes? I start with a guess solution. I want to solve this. I start with some guess solution. So let's say x0 is my guess solution. Okay. And somehow I form a sequence. So I want to form a sequence such that xk plus 1 is generated from xk. Okay, I start with x0, so x0 will give me x1, x1 will give me x2, x2 will give me x3, and so on. Okay, a very very simple crude way of doing this is, you know, I will say, I will rearrange this equation as I plus A minus I into x equal to b. So I'll just write this as x equal to I minus a x plus b. I have just rewritten the same equation. Ax equal to b, I have written as, okay? And then I can form an iteration scheme from this as x k plus 1 is equal to I minus A xk plus B. So I start with a guess solution x0. I start with a guess solution x0. I will get x1. I put back x1. I get x2. I get a sequence of vectors. Okay. get a sequence of vectors. And then, well, I need to talk about convergence. So I will have to say when to terminate this. So I am going to terminate this when xk plus 1 minus xk, this becomes, this ratio becomes very, very small. This is less than or equal to epsilon. So epsilon is typically a very small number, 10 to the power minus 10, 10 to the power minus 8 or something. So I'm going to go on doing this iterations. Well, I'll write a more generic form of the iterations. I'm going to put a generic iteration here. Xk plus 1 is equal to I minus ma, where m is a matrix which I have to choose such that this sequence will converge to the solution. Okay? The sequence will converge to the solution. That's what I want. Okay? What will happen if m is exactly equal to A inverse? If m is exactly equal to A inverse, then you will get the solution, right? Because it is A inverse B. Okay? Here, m is called as approximate inverse of A. How to do this iterations, how to construct the iterations, we'll see now. But basic idea is this, that I'm starting with a guess, I construct a new guess, and I go on iterating till it converges to a solution. Okay. Another way of looking at the convergence is through a residue. So I look at this residue vector, which is, I look at this residue vector b minus, when you arrive at the solution, what should be this difference? It should be exactly equal to 0, but well, in numerical computations we don't look for zeros, we look at a small number. So another way, another criteria for convergence could be this rk, r vector. It's good to normalize this with B is less than or equal to some, let's say this is epsilon 1 and this is epsilon 2. So either I look for this criteria to be satisfied or I look for this criteria to be satisfied for terminating my iterations. Okay? And I'm going to iterate till I reach a solution. This is the philosophy of iterative schemes. Now, next few lectures we'll see how to form these iterations. Under what conditions you are guaranteed to converge to a solution. See, the problem you might face is that, well, I'm trying to solve a large system of equations. Okay? And I have to guess a solution. So, tough problem, because if you have to guess a vector which is 1000 cross 1 or 10,000 cross 1, how do you guess? Well, that's where you have to use your knowledge from physics, engineering, chemical engineering. But fortunately here, even if you give a wrong guess, what we'll see is that if you take care of correctly choosing this M matrix, okay, you are guaranteed convergence to the true solution. Okay, so which means even if you give a wrong guess, completely arbitrary guess, okay, you are guaranteed convergence if you understand what makes the convergence work. And that's what we are going to see. First, we are going to look at these methods, algorithmic part of it. After we are done with algorithmic part, we'll move to analysis. Under what conditions these methods converge to the solution? Okay, can you do some tweaks, tricks to make the solution converge to the solution? So those things we'll look at. Okay. So let's start developing these methods one by one. I'm going to talk about three methods which are very prominently used. One is called the Jacobi method. Some of you might have done this in your undergraduate curriculum. Now, these iterative schemes are very often used while solving partial differential equations, because you just want to go very quickly to the solution. close to the solution. Okay. Well, you might wonder, by these iterative methods, am I going to the true solution or am I going close to the true solution? Well, you are getting an approximate solution, no doubt. But even when you do Gaussian elimination, then too you are getting an approximate solution, because you are doing truncation, there are all kinds of errors. Even when you want to solve a problem AX equal to B, okay, you normally end up solving A tilde X is equal to B tilde. Okay, that is because, for example, if you have an element pi coming in your matrix, you cannot represent pi exactly. So you, when you do multiplications, okay, the computer has a finite precision, so you truncate overflow errors. So even when you solve using Gaussian elimination, you cannot construct the true solution. There also there are approximations, here also there are approximations. So nothing to feel bad about approximate solution. Okay. So okay, so let's look at this Jacobi method, which is the simplest one. Let's say this is my guess solution, kth guess solution. Okay, where k starts of course from 0. So this is my kth guess solution. Now starting from this guess, so this is my guess solution. Starting from this guess, I want to create a new guess. Okay. Now the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to look at each equation in this set of equations, line by line. Okay. I have how many equations I have? N equations in N unknowns, right? I have N equations in N unknowns. I'm going to look at each equation line by line. Let's look at the first equation. So A11 x1 k, A12 x2k up to A1n xnk is equal to B1. This is my first equation. Everyone with me on this? This is my first equation. Well, actually, since it is a guess, this is not exactly equal. Okay. But for the time being, just understand how the method is developed. Okay. I have this guess solution. I want to construct a new guess. What I'm going to do is I'm going to rearrange this equation and say that x1 k plus 1 is equal to b1, okay, minus, okay, I'll put this a11 here, b1 minus a12 x2k a1n xnk. Is this fine? Okay. So now my new guess is going to be x1 k plus 1 is 1 by a11 into b1 minus. Okay, see, I'm starting from the previous guess. Okay, I'm constructing the new guess for x1. Is this clear what I have done? Just looked at one equation. Okay, well, of course, my assumption is that A11 is not 0. A11 is not 0. How will I use the second equation? I can do the same trick. Okay. So my second equation, if I just skip in between steps, I can write my second equation x2 k plus 1 is equal to 1 by a22 into b2 minus a21 x1 k minus a23 x3 k minus a 2 n xnk. Use the second line. Okay, take x2 on the left hand side. Use the second row in the equation, second equation. Take x2 on the left hand side. Okay, and you will get this equation. I have just done the same thing, which is here. Okay, if you are confused with, I can take this inside. If plus helps better to compare with the previous expression, then there is a close brace here, close brace here. Okay, this is the first element, this is the third element, second element has been taken on the left hand side. Is everyone with me on this? Is this clear? Okay, likewise I can go and my, in general I can write that xi k plus 1 is 1 by aii bi minus, well, equation 59, if you have the notes just correct them, this should be not b2, it should be bi. It is bi minus ai1. Okay. So I have written the expression in general for the ith row. I have written expression for the ith row. In ith row, what is the implicit assumption here? The implicit assumption is that all the diagonal elements are non-zero. So if it is not like that, you have to do a rearrangement of your equation such that all the diagonal elements are non-zero. That's the critical thing here. You cannot implement this algorithm unless that is done. But you can see here, it's very, very simple. It's very, very simple to do these calculations. I am just generating from the old guess, I am generating a new guess. Okay, yeah. That is another modification. So she has rightly guessed the next modification, which is called as Gauss-Seidel method. Okay, Smita, right? So Smita, like. Yeah, but this is the obvious thing to do next is that if you are generating a new guess here, in the next expression, when you go here in x2, why continue with the old guess? Right? See, I'm generating here in this step, I'm going to start from 1. Okay, so I'm first going to generate x1 k plus 1. Having generated x1 k plus 1, here I need not use old guess. I could replace this by k plus 1. Okay, I could just replace this by k plus 1. Likewise, when I go to x3, I will use x1, x2 new and x4 to xn old and so on. Okay, so in general, here, ith expression, I'll use k x1 k plus 1 up to I minus 1, and I plus 1 onwards I'll use the old values. Okay, I plus I minus 1 I'll use the old values. This is obvious modification. This is called as Gauss-Seidel method, and what you can show is that convergence of this method is much better than the Jacobi method. Okay, this method will converge much faster than the Jacobi method, and this is very, very, very simple to implement. In fact, even in terms of computer storage, this is easier to do because here, in the earlier case, you have to maintain two separate vectors. One is the old guess, other is the new guess. Here, You can just keep using the new value which is created. Those of you who know programming well will appreciate that. You don't have to maintain two vectors. You can just have one vector and just write these equations. The new value will be automatically used in the next equation. Okay. So this is implementation wise, this is much, much efficient. This is also convergence properties are better. We'll see why convergence properties are better a little later. So this is one modification that that we do to come up with iteration scheme. Now there is one more modification called as over relaxation method, and I'll talk about it in my next class, or relaxation method. So we say that, well, from Jacobi to Gauss-Seidel, you are actually you end up making the convergence faster. So why not even further accelerate by putting some acceleration parameter? Okay, so this acceleration parameter business will it's actually called relaxation parameter. This relaxation parameter business we'll see later. But these iterative methods tend to work much faster than the conventional methods. Okay, so for large scale systems, many times these iterative methods are preferred as against, and the solutions that you get are pretty much close. Okay, if you do a MATLAB experiment in which you solve a problem using iterative methods, and probably you can also check how many number of multiplications and divisions are required. So you will get an idea which particular method is faster. So the next class onwards we'll start on how to analyze this convergence. How do you make sure that convergence will occur? Are there any tricks to enhance the convergence? So all those things we'll see from our next class. So it would help if you bring these notes because there are too many summations, IJK business, and instead of writing it, I want to explain it more than spending time on writing on the board. So just get copy of the notes and then we can do it. So the other thing which I'm going to do is, this is what I've written is the algorithmic part of it. Okay, I'm going to rearrange these equations in the matrix form. Okay, because once I write these equations in the matrix form, it is easier for me to analyze this equation, the convergence behavior. It's difficult to analyze in this raw form. This raw form is useful for implementation. You can write algorithm in this way. Okay, but analysis, when will it converge and all, will require rearranging these calculations into some nice matrix forms. And we'll look at the matrix properties and say when will convergence occur. Okay, so that's what we'll do next.